from the JAMA Network. This is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Author Interview. I'm Ann Cappola, Senior Editor at JAMA, Professor of Medicine at the Perelman School of Medicine at the University of Pennsylvania, and Director of the Penn Medical Communication Research Institute. Joining me today is Dr. Svetlana Mojsov, Research Associate Professor at the Rockefeller University in New York. We will be discussing her JAMA viewpoint, Chemistry Matters, From a Putative Peptide to Effective Treatments for Diabetes and Obesity, the 2024 Lasker DeBakey Clinical Medicine Research Award. This award has been presented to Drs. Mojsov, Habner, and Knudsen for the discovery of glucagon-like peptide 1 and the use of GLP-1 receptor agonists in the treatment of diabetes and obesity. Congratulations and welcome, Dr. Mojsov.
Thank you.
Every scientific breakthrough has a story. Would you tell us the story of how you started working on GLP-1? What did you find?
So my interest in how peptides regulate glucose metabolism goes back to my graduate student years in the mid-1970s with Bruce Merrifield at the Rockefeller University in New York. We were interested to understand glucagon biology. And one approach to understand glucagon biology was to synthesize glucagon analogs and inhibitors. The best way to do that was the stepwise solid phase method, which was developed by Bruce Merrifield in the early 1960s. My PhD thesis was to develop a very efficient synthesis of glucagon, which can be then extended to glucagon analogs. I went through two syntheses. The second one was very important because that was the approach which I used when I was synthesizing GLP-1 to prove that it's an incretin. My knowledge in the sequence of glucagon and also knowledge of glucagon biology gave me good background and provided a scientific insight for my discovery of GLP-1. So when I examined the sequence of pre-proglucagon, which was in my laboratory at the endocrine unit at the Massachusetts General Hospital, the sequence which Bell published in the summer of 1983 of GLP-1 was 37 amino acids long. But when I review it carefully, I noticed that there is a single basic amino acid, an arginine, in the sequence that could be enzymatically cleaved and which will release a smaller peptide of 31 amino acids, which I just gave a generic name of GLP-1 7 to 37. The sequence of GLP-1 7 to 37 showed a perfect alignment with the amino acids in glucagon, which I knew that important for the biological activity of glucagon. And so I predicted that 7 to 37 would be the active sequence and that 7 to 37 would be the long sought after incretin. Incretins were peptides which are secreted upon ingestion of a meal or just oral glucose, which are secreted in the intestines and stimulate insulin secretion from the pancreas. I postulated that actually 7 to 37 would be the sought-after incretin. So then I had to prove that. And to do that, I developed very sensitive analytical methods. And using those methods at the endocrine unit in my laboratory at the Massachusetts General Hospital, I actually detected the presence of GLP-1 7 to 37 in the intestines. And that was the first step in showing that 7 to 37 is the incretin. Immediately, Joel Habner and I collaborated with Dr. Gordon Weir at the Justin Diabetes Center in Boston. Our experiments showed that 7 to 37, it's a very potent insulotropic peptide in the perfused rat pancreas model, which Weir developed. And the concentrations of 7 to 37, which were required for the potent insulotropic effect, were very low, the physiological concentration, the same ones as the one which are found in circulations. So these two experiments provided a proof that 7 to 37 is the incretin. We published these results within a few months. The first one was in the fall of 1986 in the Journal of Biological Chemistry. And the second paper with Gordon Weir was early 1987. And so they established, those two papers were the first one taken together, which established GLP-1 as being an incretin.
That's a fantastic story. Was there an aha moment where you realized the therapeutic potential of your discovery?
Oh, yes. And that was really from my collaboration and Habner's collaboration with David Nathan. And it was really the first clinical study which was conducted with the synthetic GLP-1 7 to 37, which I synthesized in 1984 at the endocrine unit. So David's fellows infused 7 to 37 in patients with type 2 diabetes. And when I analyzed their results with my research assistant, Adesi Allen, we found that every patient that infusion in 7 to 37 led to increase in insulin levels and decrease in glucose levels in every patient who received the peptide. It was a double-blinded study, and it was very clear by looking at the results who received the 7 to 37 and who was the control. It was at that very moment that I was convinced that it has therapeutic potential and is going to be developed as a new medicine for treatment of type 2 diabetes. And in 2010, about 20 years later, Federal Drug Administration approved the first GLP-1 analog, liraglutide, which was developed by the Novo Nordisk pharmaceutical company as a new and, as it turned out, very efficient medicine for diabetes. And several years later came a second compound, semaglutide, known now as Ozempic, which is even more efficient and which has a longer half-life of 1 week.
Did you realize at that time that it would also have utility in weight loss, or was it really just the diabetes focus?
So the focus was on diabetes. And in the 1980s, there was really no scientific evidence that the hormones can influence weight. That was really first time realized in the mid-90s when Jeff Friedman at the Rockefeller University cloned leptin. The insight that 7 to 37 regulates weight came actually from the large clinical study in Germany, in which they noticed that prolonged exposure of 7 to 37 leads to weight loss in all the participants in that study. And that was the beginning. What we have here is that my discovery that 7 to 37 is an incretin came from biological evidence. We were looking for it. But it was the clinical experiments and clinical findings which then really led to the development of GLP-1 analogs for treatment of obesity.
You're trained as a biochemist. What led you to work at a laboratory that was based in a hospital?
I always wanted to do research which will make an impact on health. And development of any new medicine requires collaboration between a chemist, biochemist, with biologists and clinicians. And a research laboratory in a hospital can provide a very good environment to actually do such studies. The discovery of GLP-1, it's a good example how that can be accomplished.
Your award is based on science that you did starting more than 40 years ago. Do you have any advice for scientists who are just starting out in their careers now?
Well, I think science, it's a very rewarding profession. It's a profession in which you can make new discoveries, which will make impacts on knowledge, and which can improve human health. And there are so many diseases for which we have to find cures for. And I think it's a very challenging project for anybody who is interested in science and who is starting a scientific career. One just has to find a subject which you're interested in. And if you're interested in that, you will just persevere and find an answer to your question. So I think there is scientific profession is the one which is the most rewarding.
Was there anything about your work that you found surprising?
Well, so the GLP-1 agonists are really open a completely new frontier, which show that a single peptide can be used to treat multiple diseases. And that goes, as we've seen now, from obesity. We know that there are very positive effects on the cardiovascular diseases and on the kidney. In the past, we used to have one medicine for one disease, but now we have with GLP-1 agonist, one medicine to treat multiple human conditions. And I think that is the most important lesson which we learn from understanding GLP-1 biology.
Thanks to Dr. Svetlana Mojsov for joining us today to discuss her work on the discovery of the incretin hormone GLP-1.
Well, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to talk about my work.
Wonderful. This is JAMA Senior Editor Dr. Ann Cappola. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit jamanetworkaudio.com. You can also listen and follow wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens.